Hallelujah.
Father, we thank you and we praise you. We love you, Lord. We magnify you. God, you're glorious in our sight. We thank you for all that you've done in our lives and all the things that you promised that you're going to do. If we only trust and believe in you. God, we thank you for this day, a day that we've never seen before. We're asking you to come and touch right now. You know every need. You know every desire. Oh, God, everything is in your hands. God, our lives, you're controlling it. Oh, God, touch us right now. Heal, deliver, set free, whatever the need is, God. We know you're able because there's nothing too hard for you. As we go into the presence of the service, oh, God, open up the understanding of your people. Let the word be received. Let it fall on good ground so that we'll grow as you want us to grow. And be the saint you called us to be in these last and evil days. And we'll give you all the honor, all the glory. It'll be yours. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. We give you glory. Illustrious ministers, we're so glad to see you all. And to all of you, each and every one of you, First Lady Sanders, God bless you. And also to the missionaries that have come from our little new brand new church of nearly 3 years. We're just thankful for these young ladies, all missionaries at the church. And we're just so glad to see you. So glad to be here. I have some kind of little light. They want to follow me. That's something right there. And I have a sister, Kyla, who's also a young lady that just wants to be with us. It's just a blessing. Amen. Thank God for, I was looking for you last night. We're just so grateful for each of you that have come and come to enjoy the Lord and grow in the Lord and feel what the spirit of the Lord down in us. Listen, we love to praise him. I don't know about you. Am I speaking for myself? But I love to praise him. I love to give him glory. I love to honor him, worship him in the dance or whatever way he tells me to praise him. I have no restrictions because when the devil told me to praise him, I did that thing.
All right, come on.
It's no need in me getting in church. Uh-huh. And all of a sudden, when the Lord tells me to get up, I didn't care what y'all thought about me when I was in the world doing anything I was big enough to do.
Come on. I certainly
can't start caring now when I have so much to be thankful for. Because God has been too good to me.
Amen.
And I'm so grateful that he chose me. Picked me up out of a life of sin and shame. He didn't have to do
it.
And every time I think about the fact that he didn't have to save me, I get excited. In May 14, 1976, he picked me up in St. Louis, Missouri and turned me around and changed my whole life. And I'm still sober.
Amen.
It doesn't get old to me.
Amen.
I don't get tired of, you know, telling it. They know the whole story. They hear it all the time. They go to 1976. Shout out to Church God, right? St. Louis. I don't care.
That's right.
If he had given me $1 million, guess what I'd still be talking about? Years later, remember that time I got $1 million? You know how we do, we won't let it go. Well, that's the way I feel about what God has done for me. But I bring you greetings from Bishop Lindsay and Mother Lindsay. They send their regards and their prayers. Continue to pray for them. They are just, as they get older, they're just more and more of a hot mess. But I'm just grateful for them. I know I am blessed. Amen. But they are praying for us. and they are praying for the success of the revival.
Amen.
If you get your Bibles, District Missionary, Mary, we're so grateful for you. Thank you. If you get your Bibles, let's go to John the 12th chapter. And we're just going to start there and kind of read around a little bit. We're thankful for last night at the end of service. The young lady came and said the Lord had filled her with the Holy Ghost. She had been praying. And she said she'd just been seeking, and we were talking about how she didn't stop. You know how a lot of us do when the service looks like it's dropping down, but we'll all try to go find our seats and go sit down. Well, then he's not coming tonight. But the lady, she persevered.
Amen.
And pressed in.
Amen.
And that's what you're going to have to do when you want something from God. You just can't, sometimes you just can't take no for an answer.
All right.
You just have to keep on pressing and saying, what more must I do, God? You know what I want and you know what I need. So I'm thankful. We know we all need the Holy Ghost. So I'm thankful she had the mind to press on and do what it takes to become filled with the Spirit of God. In John 12, as I said, I'm just going to read around and then we're going to try to work it out. Starting at the first verse. Then 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, who had been dead, whom he had raised from the dead. There they made him a supper. And Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them who sat at the table with him. In the ninth verse, now a great many of the Jews knew that he was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might also see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priest plotted to put Lazarus to death also. Because on account of him, many of the Jews went away and believed in Jesus. John 10:10 says, the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy, but I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. We're living in a day when I found out that we are getting more and more comfortable fraternizing with the devil. Fraternizing, associating closely with members of a hostile group. Not just a member of a group, but a hostile group. That means that group is not for you. That group is against you. Our best friends now in the church don't even have to be saved. Some don't even go to church. But you can get along with them better than you can with the people that's members of your church. They can get us to hang out with them. But when we ask them to come to church, they can't come. They have excuses. They have reasons. Not this time, maybe next time, but that's our best friend. That's our buddy. That's our ride or die. We're dating the unchurched. Well, they didn't let us do that years and years ago. But now we can date people. Y'all young folks, but we too old to date. When I see somebody my age tell me they got a boyfriend, it just red flag come up. Something right there. You too old to have a boyfriend. You're an old man or something, but you got a boyfriend. The subject that I want to talk to you about is the devil wants to kill you too. The devil wants to kill you too. Our culture is obsessed with familiar spirits. Mm-hmm. Spirits that are of the devil, wizards, witches, magicians, talking to the dead. You can't hardly look at TV with all that kind of foolishness just getting into the spirit of man. Luke 12 and 29 speaks of a doubtful mind, a mind that seeks guidance from astrology, fortune telling, magic, witchcraft, voodoo. These practices are carried on by people who have forsaken God and is now seeking help from demons. When you read your astrology, and you are Aquarius, and you are Taurus, and you are Capricorn, that's not God. Paul and Silas were approached by a young woman possessing such gifts. She was a fortune teller. She was fascinated by Paul and Silas, loudly announcing that they were servants of the Most High God and could show you the way to salvation. She did this for days and days, and finally, in the spirit, Paul became annoyed with her and charged it in the name of Jesus to come out of her. It did at that moment. Well, what was the problem? It was not that she was saying, because she spoke the truth. They were men of God. But where she got her information from was the problem.
Come on.
Her source was the devil. Mm-hmm. And he's a great imitator.
Yes, he is.
We have to be careful in whom we allow to counsel us. Yeah. Who we let speak into our lives. Yeah. You know, who we go to and tell all our business and then want them to tell us what to do and how to do it. We have to be careful. We can't lay our heads on everybody's breast.
Well, come on.
This was the last sin of Paul. Saul, in the Old Testament, Saul. 1 Chronicles 10, 13, and 14 says, so Saul died for his transgressions, which he committed against the Lord, even after the word of the Lord, which he kept not, and also for asking counsel of one that had a familiar spirit to ensure it, and inquired not of the Lord. Therefore he slew him and turned the kingdom unto David, the son of Jesse. Saul went to the wrong person for counsel. And because of that, he messed up. We have to stop playing with the devil, because the devil's not playing with us. For some reason, we think we can dabble and dabble with all the works of the enemy and get back. But we can't get back. We have a thing, one of our little elders that used to be at the church, he used to have a little thing about we just try to see how much we can do and get away with in the church. And I call it, we just see how far we can get and just stay on that edge. Okay, this is when you're in sin right here. Now you're in the church. And you want to stay right here. You want to taste it. You want to smell it. You want to still see it. You still want to be around it. You haven't gotten the mind to get far, far away from it. But you've got to get away from it. Because if our righteousness has filthy rags to God, then lets me know that we can do nothing, because we barely going to make it. So if we know that if we're doing all we can to be right, and then we barely gonna make it. And then here you are playing with it. Dabbling with it. Sitting on the edge like you do at the pool and kind of kicking your feet in the water. Because the water still feel kind of good, you know. I just got out of it. It still, I remember how it feel, and I liked it when I was down in that water. And I'm just gonna stay on the edge, you know, every now and then. What makes you think you're going to make it in?
My God.
You're still playing with the devil. From the beginning of time, the devil's ultimate goal was to destroy the apple of God's eye. and I. He saw the care God put into creating us. Genesis 1:26, it said, let us make man in our own image and likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Verse 28 said, and God blessed them.
Yes.
So the devil's mad because we're blessed.
Yes.
And we're so silly, we got to give up our blessing. Because of the little stuff that he throw in front of us that looks so good. We're going to give up the blessings of God for nothing. Lucifer's mad. He's mad because once he had it all, everything God had given to us, he had. He was perfect, the Bible says. In his ways from the day that he was created until iniquity was found in him, and then he was thrown out of heaven. So he wants the same thing to happen to me and you that's happened to him. John 12:1-2, it lets us know that the focus in this text seems to be on Lazarus. Lazarus and Jesus had history. In the previous chapter, we see Lazarus, the brother of Mary and Martha, he had become ill. And it seems that as the days went on, he became sicker and sicker. He became so ill that his sisters turned and said, go get Jesus. We need some help here. They had seen the miracles he had performed, and they knew that they needed one right now. His family had developed a relationship with Jesus. They knew him on a personal level, and he ate at their house. And for that, that was meaningful. You don't eat with everybody back then. You know, when you suck with somebody, you are like this. And he had eaten at their house. Every time he went to Bethany, he went to their house to sit and eat with them. They had known him as a teacher. They had known him on a social level. But now they were getting ready to know him, as Paul said in Philippians 3:10, in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. The breadwinner was sick. And if he dies, they're in a dire strait, because it looked like those two girls were nothing but socialites. Mary and Martha were simply little bougie girls. And they couldn't make it if Lazarus died. He was taking care of his little sisters. All they knew how to do was throw a party. Have a good time. And here this man is who's holding them up. About like me. Some out of the night. They know things were going to go bad. So they love their brother. But they also realize we got to keep this man here. They sent a message saying, behold, he whom you love, is sick. Stop that, will do it, because you know, he's going to come, because I sent a message at your friend, your bosom buddy. He said, he said, and I wouldn't sit by you if you wasn't real sick. It's not looking good. We're calling you because you know we're close, and we're nearly like relatives, and the prognosis is grim, and we really need you to hurry. How many of us have asked Jesus to hurry?
Yeah, where is
that? Found out he put out a little call on hold. When Jesus put you on hold, they tell us, don't hang up.
Come on.
Just hold on. He's coming back. Just hold on. He has a purpose and a plan. For putting you on hold. Just for keep believing that he will do just what he said. If the devil can't get you, he will try to get the one that's closest to you. He's not going to stop until he affects you some kind of way. He fights dirty. He'll get your spies. Get his mind all tangled up. On the way down here tonight, one of my girlfriends, a young lady, not my girlfriend, she's a young lady that we work with at Calvary. Her daughter sent her off to school September. Now she's left school, living with a man, and she don't know where she is.
My God.
She's happy. The little mama was happy. Just got married. Lord was blessing. Married a little preacher. Things were going good, and the devil got mad.
Yeah.
And he attacked her baby.
Yeah.
So now she's asking us, y'all pray for my child. I don't know where she is.
My God.
Jesus.
He's going to attack you and what's closest to you. Your parents. Your siblings. Anybody that's in your heart who you love. He's going to attempt to destroy. But we are all covered by the blood of Jesus. So Jesus was close enough. He could have made it. He could have made it before Lazarus died. It was no problem, really. But he purposely delayed going to see about him. When he heard the news, he stayed 2 more days and said to his disciple, our friend Lazarus is sleeping. But I go that I may wake him out of his sleep. Well, you know I say all the time at our church that the disciples were never the sharpest knives in the drawer. As long as they've been around Jesus, as much as they've seen him do, they never understood nothing he said. So they're looking at him saying, we're going to go away. They just look. So, Lazarus, Martha, Mary, Lazarus seem to be the focus of that 12, 1 and 2. Now he's up. He's doing good. His life has become a testimony. Now of the power of Jesus Christ. He's been made whole. He's been healed. But in verse 9, the people knew that Jesus was there. But they didn't come to see Jesus. They came to see Lazarus. Who being raised from the dead. You want to know how to get West End so full that they standing out in the street? Raise somebody from the dead. Start healing people. Start believing in healing. Let me say it right there. Let us not be sick. Let's be well enough that when someone comes in sick, we can lay hands on them and they shall recover. Now, when you start having miracles in your church, folk come. That's how the church of God in Christ started. Because Bishop Mason, he wasn't an expounder per se. He wasn't a preacher per se. But when he prayed, blind were healed. Deaf began to hear. Legs grew.
Jesus.
All kind of miracles. Throwing away canes. Getting out of wheelchairs. He gave us this power so that men would believe.
Yes.
We got the power. But we won't use it. We won't even use it on ourselves. They wanted to see Lazarus. They knew him from around the way. He was from the neighborhood, and they could relate to his life. And if Jesus could work a miracle in his life, surely he could work one for them. We are all miracles if we tell the truth about it. We know and think about where the Lord brought us from. You know, I know I'm a miracle. My life was so rough, folks would say, if you get saved, I know I'm going to get saved. And then when I got saved, it shocked them so bad they couldn't believe it. And they still stand around looking at it. Waiting on me to fall. You know how the devil does. 40 years later, I'm still holding on. Listen, it's a day by day.
Yes, Lord.
Right. Ain't no greatness in me. It's a day by day. Lord, keep me.
Come on, yes. Come on.
He's the same day by day.
Day by day.
So we have to realize that the devil is trying to kill us too.
Uh-huh. Yes, he is.
I can relate to Lazarus. To his life. And how Jesus worked that miracle in his life. It was his amazing grace that freed us.
All right.
But because of the light that your life shines, the devil wants to kill you. The chief priest's hearts had become hardened. They had rejected Jesus and had plans to kill him.
Uh-huh.
And wanted Lazarus dead because he was a living testimony.
Uh-huh.
His life exemplified power.
Uh-huh.
That was the power of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
God had saved, healed, and delivered us. And the devil, he's mad.
Yes.
He's enlarged in hell just for us.
Yes.
And here God is going around sending power so that we don't even have to go.
My.
And he's making room for us.
Uh-huh.
But you need to look around and tell the devil, I'm not coming.
Jesus.
I'm not coming. Because God has saved me.
Yeah.
The people looked at Lazarus and believed on Jesus. The people looked at Lazarus and believed on Jesus.
Yes, yes.
Are you a mirror that reflects Jesus?
Glory.
Is your life
uh-huh.
a mirror that say that person is saved?
Uh-huh.
I was at a program the other night. Not a coaching program. And I was just sitting there, and there was a lot of things going on. A lot of things. I usually don't, not that I'm antisocial, but it's just I'm just laid back by nature.
Mm-hmm.
I don't go to a whole bunch of places, period.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not about church, it's just how I was raised up all the child by myself, and I just like to stay at home a lot. But as I was sitting there, and everybody was up and doing and being and having and singing and flinging and flipping and flopping. And it was a lot going on. I said, whoa. And finally, when it was my time to present, God bless us, amen, for Bishop.
Amen.
And when it was my time to present, and I was to just talk about the person that we were honoring on that night, and they said, and also after that, you go on and you sing or something, because it was kind of like a music thing. But the man that I don't know, never knew, don't know nothing about him, the first thing he said was, "I'm the lady that I'm presenting to you, I could just look at her and I see the Spirit of God all over her."
All right.
Praise God.
I'm saying, how can you see anything up in here and all this here? But anyway, it's wonderful when people can see.
Amen.
See, it's time out for saints of God to try to start being like
well,
the world.
Yes.
The world actually is sick of us
yes.
trying to be like them.
That's right.
They want us to go somewhere and sit down.
That's right.
If you say, be saved.
Yes.
If you're among them, be among them. It's time for us to be real. If you're not going to be saved, just get on out there, go on to hell. Because that's where you're going. And get that over with. And stop blocking and having folk looking at you talking about, that's why I don't go to church. Because see how they do the same thing. I do. Ain't no difference in me. See, you're just a pet for the devil.
My God.
Little right. Little saint. Little holy.
Yeah.
And if you're not ready, just get on out the way.
Jesus.
Stop letting the devil use you.
Because
that's all he's doing. It's using you. So the people looked at Lazarus. The people were able to look at Lazarus and believe on Jesus just by looking at him. Isn't that something? Do you look like your daddy? I look like my dad.
Yes, Lord.
My my natural and my spiritual dad. You know that I'm a lens. You just know that. Just like you know that I'm a lens, I want you to look at me and know that I'm a child of God. I don't want nothing in me to reflect nothing, that I, but I'm saved and I'm sanctified. Filled with the Holy Ghost and Christ.
Amen.
I don't want nothing to come out of my mouth that I don't care how you thought I was saved, but I opened my mouth and then I discouraged you.
My God.
I made you feel bad. Because, like I said about this young man in our church, he got this thing about, you know, how people pressure Satan, push us and on these jobs and different places. And he said, well, I ain't forgot how to cuss. See, no, we ain't forget.
Right.
It's just we don't know it no more. No. It's a lot of things that we did when we were in the world. We haven't forgot how to do it. But because of God in our lives, we don't do that thing no more. Ain't nobody for God. I know I'm close. Ain't nobody for God. Look at your neighbor and say, ain't nobody for God. Jesus called him out of the grave, stepped out, bound at the hand and feet, face covered with a napkin.
Jesus
said, free him of his burial clothes and let him go. When we come to church, we come down that aisle, dead on right. Sin has killed us. But God breathed the breath of life down in us. And Jesus touched our hearts and made our hearts right. And the Holy Ghost is now residing in us so that we can live right. And the Trinity has made us over. And the Trinity is still keeping us. You are a living testimony. People are looking at you. But just like people are looking at you and your reflection and the goodness of God that's on you, the devil wants to kill you too. Because he knows who you represent.
That's right.
We sing this song. I'm on my way to heaven and I'm so glad. The devil can't do me no harm. Don't lean in.
Come on.
He can mess you up.
Yes,
he can mess your mind up.
All right.
He can mess your family up. But when he's doing his message,
yes,
you got to have so much down in here in you that you make a stand. And you said, for God, I need you're going to have to be like Job. All my point of time.
Yeah.
I'm just going to wait. Just don't wait till the change comes. You just have to make a stand because you already got the warning that he don't try to kill you too. So it's no use in you being all excited and Lord, why this gets on my real nerve when I hear saints because why Jesus this happened to me? I just don't understand. What is it about that you don't understand? The devil trying to kill you too. He comes to John 10:10. Kill, steal, and destroy. That is the mission of the devil. And it's his purpose thing. That's what he does. That's who he is. I respect him for doing what he do. But are you doing what you're supposed to do? Are you staying where you're supposed to stay? Oh, please. That I don't care if everyone's standing. I'm not no hooping and hollering tonight. That's it. When you get into any kind of situation, we can't leave you in the fire. Three Hebrew boys, you know. He wasn't Jesus didn't leave him in the fire. Daniel and the lion did. He didn't leave him in the fire. Jesus is not going to leave you in the fire. In the lion's den. In trouble. He said, no, I'll be with you always. He's with you. I don't care what the devil is telling you in your mind. I don't care what he's telling you in your spirit. I don't care how lonely you feel and how alone and you feel like, you know, I prayed some prayers and looked like they would bounce up on the ceiling and come back down and fall on the floor. But I just had to remember what the word said. I'm with you. Now this is it. Now what I feel it.
All right.
You know, because the feelings will trick you.
Yes.
There are times I don't feel like he's around. I feel like he's forgot me. I feel like I'm on hold. And I'm saying, well, Lord, it looks like I've been on hold a long time. Looks like I've been stuck in this place a long time. When are you going to help me?
Yeah.
God, I need help.
Yeah.
Oh, hallelujah.
I don't know about you, but I've been in a place where all I could say was help.
Help me.
I couldn't talk to nobody else. I couldn't tell nobody else. I didn't have no BFF to go to except for him here.
Right.
Because I didn't know the mess I was in and the things that I was feeling. Best friend couldn't help me.
Right.
All right. Only Jesus could help me.
Thank you.
And I recognized that the devil was trying to destroy him.
Jesus.
Take away my testimony. Then that's when I had to just stay.
Yes.
And when you've done all, when you've done everything, when you prayed, like the brother said, just prayed and it looked like nothing was happening.
All right.
Just stay.
Stay.
You're going to go through something, saints.
Amen.
And it's just time for us to stop being whining, saints. And be strong in the Lord. And the power. Yes. See, I'm not giving you a spirit of what?
Fear.
But a
power. Love. Sound mind.
You just have to keep telling yourself. Telling yourself.
Yeah.
I don't have this fearful spirit. I don't care what's going on. I don't care how bad it looks.
All right.
I belong to God and he's in control. I belong to him. He's my daddy. And he's not going to let the devil kill me.
Amen.
And you just have to talk with the spirit that's in you, talking to you, like that.
Yes.
I love to God. No, go. Leave me alone. No. Do that. Stop. Don't come out with these old crying. Easy. I don't know why this is easy. The day is out. The day is up.
Okay, yes.
Most of y'all been saved too long to be doing it anyhow. Most of us, way too long to whine and cry and complain. But we praise him. See, the Bible said the joy of the Lord is your strength. See, and it's not always running and hollering and running into the wall and water. And that's good. I like that. Don't get me wrong now. I like that. I like it. I enjoy that.
Amen.
But the joy sometimes is when you're going through. Mm-hmm. You're not going through with a long face wanting somebody
else.
What's wrong with you? Mm-hmm. Why are you looking like that? See, you want sin.
Mm-hmm.
That ain't what you need.
That's it.
You need a strong word from the Lord.
Yes.
You need somebody who's going to be able to come and talk to you and pray with you and encourage you. See, and when you're dealing with people that's just as weak as you, they can't do nothing. Yeah, they ain't gonna do nothing, but the blind can't leave the blind, but they ain't gonna do nothing but what? So, but that's what the devil will do. He'll get you to attach you to somebody who's just as weak as you. And that's all y'all do, just fall upon one another and cry. I just want somebody to talk to. You know how we do. Now, I guess he said, silly, you talking to me.
Okay.
Who else can help?
Amen.
But Jesus.
Amen.
Who else can bring me through?
Amen.
Who else can heal my broken
yes,
heart?
Sir. Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Who else can mend
Glory.
My brokenness?
Amen.
Yes.
Who else can touch my mind when it's just so confused?
Come on.
The reason we can't go to him is because we have not developed that relationship with him. I can go to Tina because me and Tina talk every day. But do you talk every day to Jesus?
Come on.
See, that's what you have to go back. When you develop a relationship with somebody, you ain't got no problem just going straight to him and telling him.
Come on.
How's your relationship? Whereas when the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy, he can't have you because you are so tight with the Lord.
Jesus.
You and Jesus walking so close.
Yeah.
He can't get to you. He can't have you. He can't touch your mind. He can't give you no doubt in your spirit.
Glory.
He can't.